Macmillan Audio presents The Boy at the Top of the Mountain by John Boyne, narrated for you by Alex Wyndham.
Part 1, 1936. Chapter 1, Three Red Spots on a Handkerchief. Although Pierrot Fischer's father didn't die in the Great War, his mother, Emily, always maintained it was the war that killed him. Pierrot wasn't the only seven-year-old in Paris to live with just one parent. The boy who sat in front of him at school hadn't laid eyes on his mother in the 4 years since she'd run off with an encyclopedia salesman, while the classroom bully, who called Pierrot Le Petit because he was so small, had a room above his grandparents' tobacco shop on the Avenue de la Motte-Piquet, where he spent most of his time dropping water balloons from the upstairs window onto the heads of passers-by below, and then insisting that it had nothing to do with him. And in an apartment on the ground floor of his own building, on the nearby Avenue Charles Floquet, Pierrot's best friend Angèle Bronstein lived alone with his mother, Madame Bronstein, his father having drowned 2 years earlier during an unsuccessful attempt to swim the English Channel. Having been born only weeks apart, Pierrot and Angèle had grown up practically as brothers, one mother taking care of both babies when the other needed a nap. But unlike a lot of brothers, they never argued. Angèle had been born deaf, so the boys had developed a sign language early on, communicating easily and expressing through nimble fingers everything they needed to say. They even created special symbols for each other to use instead of their names. Angèle gave Pierrot the sign of the dog, as he considered his friend to be both kind and loyal, while Pierrot adopted the sign of the fox for Angèle, who everyone said was the smartest boy in their class. They spent most of their time together, kicking a football around in the Champ de Mars and reading the same books. So close was their friendship that Pierrot was the only person Angèle allowed to read the stories he wrote in his bedroom at night. Not even Madame Bronstein knew that her son wanted to be a writer.
"This one's good,"
Pierrot would sign, his fingers fluttering in the air as he handed back a bundle of pages.
"I like the bit about the horse and the part where the gold is discovered hidden in the coffin. This one's not so good,"
he would continue, handing back a second sheaf.
"But that's because your handwriting is so terrible that I wasn't able to read some parts. And this one,"
he would add, waving a third pile in the air as if he was at a parade.
"This one doesn't make any sense at all. I'd throw this one in the bin if I were you." "It's experimental,"
signed Angèle, who didn't mind criticism, but could sometimes be a little defensive about the stories his friend enjoyed the least.
"No,"
signed Pierrot, shaking his head.
"It just doesn't make any sense. You should never let anyone read this one. They'll think you've lost your marbles."
Pierrot, too, liked the idea of writing stories, but he could never sit still long enough to put the words down on the page. Instead, he sat on a chair opposite his friend and just started signing, making things up, or describing some escapade that he had got up to in school, and Angèle would watch carefully before transcribing them for him later.
"So, did I write this?"
Pierrot asked when he was finally given the pages and read through them.
"No, I wrote it,"
Angèle replied, shaking his head.
"But it's your story."
Emily, Pierrot's mother, rarely talked about his father anymore, although the boy still thought of him constantly. Wilhelm Fischer had lived with his wife and son until 3 years earlier, but left Paris in the summer of 1933, a few months after his son's fourth birthday. Pierrot remembered his father as a tall man who would mimic the sounds of a horse as he carried the boy on his broad shoulders through the streets, breaking into an occasional gallop that always made Pierrot scream with delight. He taught his son German to remind him of his ancestry and did his best to help him learn simple songs on the piano, though Pierrot knew he would never be as accomplished as his father. Papa played folk songs that brought tears to the eyes of visitors, particularly when he sang along in that soft but powerful voice that spoke of memory and regret. If his musical skills were not great, Pierrot made up for this with his skill at languages. He could flit between speaking German to his father and French to his mother with no difficulty whatsoever. His party trick was singing La Marseillaise in German and then Das Deutschlandlied in French, a skill that sometimes made dinner guests uncomfortable.
I don't want you doing that anymore, Pierrot,
Maman told him one evening after his performance had caused a mild disagreement with some neighbors.
Learn something else if you want to show off. Juggling, magic tricks, standing on your head, anything that doesn't involve singing in German. What's wrong with German?
Asked Pierrot. Yes, Emily, said Papa from the armchair in the corner, where he had spent the evening drinking too much wine, something that always left him brooding over the bad experiences that haunted him. What's wrong with German?
Haven't you had enough, Wilhelm?
She asked, her hands pressed firmly to her hips as she turned to look at him. Enough of what? Enough of your friends insulting my country?
They weren't insulting it, she said. They just find it difficult to forget the war, that's all. Particularly those who lost loved ones in the trenches.
And yet they don't mind coming into my home, eating my food and drinking my wine? Papa waited until Maman had returned to the kitchen before summoning Pierrot over and placing an arm around his waist. Someday, we will take back what's ours, he said, looking the boy directly in the eye. And when we do, remember whose side you're on. You may have been born in France and you may live in Paris, but you're German through and through, just like me. Don't forget that, Pierrot. Sometimes Papa woke in the middle of the night, his screams echoing through the dark and empty hallways of their apartment. And Pierrot's dog, D'Artagnan, would leap in fright from his basket, jump onto his bed, and scramble under the sheets next to his master, trembling. The boy would pull the blanket up to his chin, listening through the thin walls as Maman tried to calm Papa down, whispering in a low voice that he was fine, that he was at home with his family, that it had been nothing but a bad dream. But it wasn't a dream, he heard his father say once, his voice trembling with distress. It was worse than that. It was a memory. Occasionally, Pierrot would wake in need of a quick trip to the bathroom and find his father seated at the kitchen table, his head slumped on the wooden surface, muttering to himself as an empty bottle lay on its side next to him. Whenever this happened, the boy would run downstairs in his bare feet and throw the bottle in the courtyard bin so his mother wouldn't discover it the next morning. And usually, when he came back upstairs, Papa had roused himself and somehow found his way back to bed. Neither father nor son ever talked about any of these things the next day. Once, however, as Pierrot went outside on one of these late-night missions, he slipped on the wet staircase and tumbled to the floor. Not badly enough to hurt himself, but enough to smash the bottle he was holding. And as he stood up, a piece of glass embedded itself in the underside of his left foot. Grimacing, he pulled it out. But as it emerged, a thick stream of blood began to seep quickly through the torn skin. When he hobbled back into the apartment in search of a bandage, Papa woke and saw what he had been responsible for. After disinfecting the wound and ensuring that it was tightly wrapped, he sat the boy down and apologized for his drinking. Wiping away tears, he told Pierrot how much he loved him and promised that he would never do anything to put him in harm's way again.
I love you too, Papa, said Pierrot. But I love you most when you're carrying me on your shoulders and pretending to be a horse. I don't like it when you sit in the armchair and won't talk to me or Maman.
I don't like those moments, Caesar, said Papa quietly. But sometimes it's as if a dark cloud has settled over me and I can't get it to move on. That's why I drink. It helps me forget.
Forget what?
The war. The things I saw. He closed his eyes as he whispered, the things I did. Pierrot swallowed, almost afraid of asking the question.
What did you do?
Papa offered him a sad smile. Whatever I did for my country, he said. You can understand that, can't you?
Yes, Papa,
said Pierrot, who wasn't sure what his father meant, but thought it sounded valiant, nevertheless.
I'd be a soldier too, if it would make you proud of me.
Papa looked at his son and placed a hand on his shoulder. Just make sure you pick the right side, he said. For several weeks after this, he stopped drinking. And then, just as abruptly as he had given up, that dark cloud he had spoken of returned, and he started again. Papa worked as a waiter in a local restaurant, disappearing every morning around 10 o'clock and returning at 3 before leaving again at 6 for the dinner service. On one occasion, he came home in a bad mood and said that someone named Papa Joffre had been in the restaurant for lunch, seated at one of his tables. He had refused to serve him until his employer, Monsieur Abrahams, said that if he didn't, he could go home and never return.
"Who's Papa Joffre?"
asked Pierrot, having never heard the name before.
"He was a great general in the war,"
said Maman, lifting a pile of clothes out of a basket and placing it next to her ironing board.
"A hero to our people."
"To your people," said Papa.
"Remember that you married a French woman,"
said Maman, turning to him angrily.
"Because I loved her," replied Papa. "Pierrot, did I ever tell you about when I saw your mother for the first time? It was a couple of years after the Great War ended. I had arranged to meet my sister Beatrix during her lunch break, and when I got to the department store where she worked, she was talking to one of the new assistants, a shy creature who had only started that week. I took one look at her and knew immediately that this was the girl I was going to marry."
Pierrot smiled. He loved it when his father told stories like this.
"I opened my mouth to speak, but couldn't find any words. It was as if my brain had just gone to sleep. And so I just stood there, staring, saying nothing."
"I thought there was something wrong with him,"
said Maman, smiling too at the memory.
"Beatrix had to shake me by the shoulders," said Papa, laughing at his own foolishness.
"If it wasn't for her, I would never have agreed to go out with you,"
added Maman.
"She told me I should take a chance, that you were not as daft as you seemed." "Why don't we ever see Aunt Beatrix?"
asked Pierrot, for he had heard her name on a few occasions over the years, but had never met her. She never came to visit and never wrote any letters.
"Because we don't,"
said Papa, the smile leaving his face now as his expression changed.
"But why not?"
"Leave it, Pierrot," he said.
"Yes, leave it, Pierrot,"
repeated Maman, her face clouding over now too.
"Because that's what we do in this house. We push away the people we love. We don't talk about things that matter, and we don't allow anyone to help us."
And just like that, a happy conversation was spoiled.
"He eats like a pig,"
said Papa a few minutes later, crouching down and looking Pierrot in the eye, curling his fingers into claws.
"Papa Joffre, I mean, like a rat chewing his way along a cob of corn."
Week after week, Papa complained about how low his wages were, how Monsieur and Madame Abraham spoke down to him, and how the Parisians had grown increasingly mean with their tips.
"This is why we never have any money,"
he grumbled.
"They're all so tight-fisted, especially the Jews. They're the worst, and they come in all the time because they say that Madame Abrahams makes the best gefilte fish and latkes in all of Western Europe."
"All Shell is Jewish,"
said Pierrot quietly, because he often saw his friend leaving for temple with his mother.
"Anshel is one of the good ones," muttered Papa. "They say every barrel of good apples contains a single rotten one. Well, that works the other way round too."
"We never have any money,"
said Maman, interrupting him,
"because you spend most of what you earn on wine, and you shouldn't speak about our neighbors like that. Remember how—"
"You think I bought this?"
he asked, picking up a bottle and turning it round to show her the label, the same house wine that the restaurant used.
"Your mother can be very naive sometimes,"
he added in German to Pierrot. Despite everything, Pierrot loved spending time with his father. Once a month, Papa would take him to the Tuileries garden, where he would name the different trees and plants that lined the walkways, explaining how each one changed as season followed season. His own parents, Papa told him, had been avid horticulturalists and had loved anything to do with the land.
"But they lost it all, of course," he added. "Their farm was taken from them, all their hard work destroyed. They never recovered."
On the way home, he bought ice creams from a street seller, and when Pierrot's fell to the ground, his father gave him his instead. These were the things that Pierrot tried to remember whenever there was trouble at home. Only a few weeks later, An argument broke out in their front parlour when some neighbours, different ones to those who had objected to Pierrot singing La Marseillaise in German, began discussing politics. Voices were raised, all grievances aired, and when they left, his parents got into a terrible fight.
If you'd only stop drinking,
Maman cried.
Alcohol makes you say the most terrible things. Can't you see how much you upset people?
I drink to forget.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.